Welcome back, another question to review, so let's waste no time and get started straight away. Okay, so this is the question that we're going to be reviewing. The question is, you are auditing a serverless application for a university enrollment system. The application uses API Gateway, S3 and Lambda to provide the front-end serverless compute and DynamoDB for back-end data storage. During yearly student intake periods, the system is expected to have 10,000 times the load versus other times of the year. The DynamoDB tables use provisioned capacity of 50 RCU and 50 WCU. Which architecture changes could you suggest to reduce the impact of the extra load? And you need to choose two. Now we're going to follow the same process, highlighting keywords and anything of scenario significance in the question. If you want to try this, pause the video and give it a go, and then resume and we can carry on. So let's review what I found in this question. The first thing which jumps out is serverless. Now this is a vague word at best, but it lets us know that the architecture is likely to be scalable. So for any performance issues, your default position can be that they're probably not application related. If it uses S3, API Gateway and Lambda, which it does, all three of those are scalable products, so we're probably not looking for performance issues in the front-end application. Now we can also see that it uses DynamoDB for the back-end. What makes this question special is that it's a classic example of a burst problem, an application which has a normal level of load most of the time, but then for a certain period has massively more load. Now this might be certain times of the day, certain days of the week, or sale or enrollment periods, but the architecture is always the same, a normal level of load which increases to orders of magnitude more during certain periods. Now the application uses DynamoDB and has a provisioned capacity of 50 RCU and 50 WCU. Now for this question we need to pick two correct answers, so it's slightly different than questions we've looked at previously which only required one. Now if there's two correct answers, we can either be looking at two parts of the same solution or two potentially correct solutions to this problem. So let's look at the answers that we have available. And this time we have a total of 5 answers and we need to pick 2 from this list of 5. On the surface level, the answers all look to be different. So why don't you pause the video, read through them, try to identify the key points, and then we'll step through them together and evaluate which of them are valid for this question. Okay, so let's look at what points I highlighted in these questions and you can compare those to the ones that you found. Now keep in mind for this one, we're actually looking for answers which might help in reducing the impact of the extra load experienced during these bursty periods. An important point to make is that the question didn't explicitly mention anything about cost. That's important because we're picking two answers. Maybe one of them is perfect and is a low-cost option, and another one is good but might be significantly more expensive. When we're asked to pick two answers out of a list, we need to focus initially on answers which are possible. Anything that fits, anything that meets the requirements in the question at this point will be a potentially correct answer. So let's go through them one by one. Now the first answer, we can immediately exclude it without even factoring in the question. And the reason for this is you don't launch DynamoDB databases. DynamoDB is a database table as a service product. You don't provision databases within the product, you provision DynamoDB tables. Now that sounds picky, but that's a valid distinction to make, and it gives us a reason to exclude this answer. The second answer is affected by a dynamic you've seen in previous questions. The database currently in use is DynamoDB, which is a NoSQL database. The data in it will also be NoSQL data. It will be modelled with a non-relational model. Now the answer is suggesting that you back up DynamoDB data and restore it into an Aurora serverless cluster. And this is a trick answer. The word serverless is designed to check that you know that Aurora Serverless is a SQL or a relational database product. It's not NoSQL. And the difference in these data models, so NoSQL to SQL, makes this a bad answer, so we're going to exclude it. Now let's skip ahead to the last answer. This one is self-exclusionary for two reasons. First, 500,000 RCU and WCU is above the per table limit on capacity. Now I don't expect you to know that from memory, but when you see any large values for RCU or WCU, that should be your immediate default to question whether it's above any service limits. Now, secondly, it's a known bad practice on DynamoDB to increase the RCU and WCU and then decrease it again. Increasing values causes additional partitions to be created. Reducing the values doesn't reduce the number of partitions. And this means by doing this, you can introduce long-term performance problems, so it's generally a bad idea. Now this leaves us with two correct answers, and logically both of them have to be correct. But the question is why? Well, changing the capacity from provisioned, where you explicitly set RCU and WCU, to on-demand, well, this is more expensive, but it means that AWS handle the performance behind the scenes, so it is a potentially valid answer, and at this stage that's good enough. Now the other answer involves adding an SQS queue. The application is modified to write to the queue rather than the database, and then a Lambda function can parse the queue and write data into the table over time, leveling out the load over that same time period. Now this is a pretty common architecture for leveling writes to a DynamoDB table, and so it's something to be aware of. Now these are the two answers that I'd select for this question. Now you might be thinking that neither of them are amazing solutions, and you would be 100% right. These answers were actually crafted to show you an example of a question with answers which you might find to be suboptimal. They might be bad answers, but they are the least bad of the answers available. And this is often how pro-level or specialty-level questions are architected, where you have to pick the least bad answer from a collection of bad answers. Okay, well that's everything for this question. I hope it made sense, and I hope it gives you an idea of how to answer this type of question. Thanks for watching. Go ahead and complete this video, and then when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.